So I told my mother I was going to an event with Superintendent McCarthy and Prosecutor Fitzgerald, and there was this long pause. And when all my indiscretions from my teenage years went through my mind, and she said, "What kind of an event?" I'm the bridge to schools. And I know Jean-Claude is here, and the other panelists, I hope, are here. There was this question about, what about social services? There are $7 billion being spent on one particular social service in this city, which is called the Chicago Public Schools, which is probably the most important social service for us to leverage if we're going to do something both about crime and about the future of the kids in Chicago. Some facts you know. The higher your level of educational attainment, the longer you are likely to live. This seems important. There's a 10-year swing between a high school graduate and a high school dropout. The more you are likely to earn, $1 million swing, the less likely you will be to go to prison. There's a 47 times greater likelihood that you will be in prison if you don't finish high school versus finishing some post-secondary education. The more likely you will vote, volunteer, give blood, have children with higher levels of educational attainment, this social service, Jean-Claude, that you are responsible for matters enormously. So here's the peril in Chicago. And then I want to say something quickly about the promise and then bring up the panel. First is a study that we did at the Urban Education Institute now in 2006, where we looked at every ninth grader in Chicago public schools and tracked them through a four-year college degree. And we found that 6.5% of ninth graders have a four-year college degree by the time they're 25. And if you're an African-American boy or a Latino boy, approximately 3% have a four-year college degree by the time they're 25. That excluded students with disabilities. So this is really, we're looking at 1 in 50 African-American boys in ninth grade have a four-year college degree by the time they're 25. I know I'm being relentless about this, but that's beyond broken. So that's the peril, right? We've got a system that is not delivering, that is going to re-deliver the kids into the same cycles that we just heard about. And yet we're spending enormous amounts of money on it and getting, frankly, not nearly enough leverage. Even though I was given 10 minutes, I'm going to catch you up, Rosanna. Why am I hopeful even in the face of that kind of evidence? After that study that looked at educational outcomes of ninth graders, we dug in a bit deeper and said, why? What are the reasons that kids are falling apart, dropping out, not finishing post-secondary school? And we found some really, really important things. One of them, turns out, is that ninth grade really matters. Whether you are on track as a ninth grader in terms of your GPA, your passing, courses passed, and attendance, really, really matters. In fact, it matters. It's a better predictor. Your ninth grade performance is a better predictor than your race, than your income, than your prior test scores combined. It's a better predictor of whether you will finish high school, your ninth grade performance. So then we worked with Chicago Public Schools over the last 4 or 5 years. They built systems to track that indicator, to feed it back to schools, to feed it back to teachers and school leadership. And the on-track rates in ninth grade in Chicago over the last 5 years have gone from 55% to 73% as of this fall. That's 5,000 more students we can reliably predict will finish high school per annum in Chicago. So this is encouraging. This does suggest you can move these big systems in significant ways, and we know from the earlier data I alluded to, the likelihood drops dramatically in terms of participation in crime as students generate more and more educational attainment. Another reason I'm hopeful, another pothole on the path to college, as we called it, was paying for it. Surprise, surprise. I don't know how many of you have heard of this thing called the FAFSA. The FAFSA is the federal financial aid form. It's like the Byzantine form, worse than taxes. And there was this great moment where, and so the FAFSA is hard to fill out. You have a very small window. It's your only shot, if you have no money, at getting financial aid from the federal government. And yet it's convoluted and difficult just to do the form. So there was a great moment in the White House with then Chief of Staff Rahm Emanuel, Arne Duncan, the Secretary of Education, and Doug Shulman, who's the Commissioner of the IRS, where they announced this the streamlining of this FAFSA. And I thought, I've arrived. This little band of researchers on the south side of Chicago has actually got the IRS to do something. I'm done. But the real promise is this. In Chicago alone, the percentage of seniors in high school, in Chicago public schools, who are successfully applying for federal financial aid has gone from 63 to 87%. So that's, again, another indication that this is possible and that we can move the needle in significant ways that will get at the educational attainment goals we should be after. Finally, one other thing. Our research shop did a study on school safety this year. We just published it a few months ago. And we found that even in Chicago's most dangerous neighborhoods, schools are having a significant effect on student safety. So the schoolhouse is this really important antidote. The schoolhouse itself, in terms of not just helping children feel safer, but be safer. There are five things the schools were doing, focusing on, none of them will surprise you, focusing on the quality of instruction, leadership, school culture, the school climate, the professional capacity of the teachers, and parent and community engagement. What might surprise you is if you get three of five of those things right, you're 10 times more likely to make substantial improvement and 30 times less likely to stagnate, even in Chicago's most dangerous neighborhoods. Schools can have an incredibly important effect on our students. So I'm the bridge. I just bridged crime and education. If we're serious about getting there, that's the only way. The last question on the previous panel is really, in my view, the only way we're going to make radical differences in the lives of the children that we serve. The Crime Lab has done remarkable work to date, and now its new young sister, the Urban Education Lab, aims to build knowledge and provide information about cost effectiveness of particular interventions that will help us do this at a much, much different level in Chicago and across the country. So with that, I want to introduce Stephanie Banchero, who is the person who will lead our next panel, focusing on this social service question, education question. Stephanie is a Wall Street Journal reporter covering K-12 issues nationally. She is pithy, she is unambiguous, and very smart, and worked for a newspaper that actually I think is here in Chicago, but I can't remember its name. What is its name? It's the Tribune. The Tribune is the paper you worked for. And she is going to take us through the rest of the morning. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm sorry to see that half the audience has left. I want to say something about Tim. Last time I saw him speak, he got the audience all energized, and I was sort of hoping for a similar provocative comment. We were talking about training teachers, and he called colleges of education cartels. And when he said it, I tweeted it out right from the conference and got about 200,000 responses from people saying he didn't know what he was talking about.
So. Who? Jeb Bush.
Oh, yes, shocking. So I'm happy to be here today. I think that you gave a great bridge to that. I just want to say a couple quick facts that I got out of the newspaper, so if they're wrong, you can blame the Tribune, my former newspaper. There was a story recently in the Tribune that said that the Chicago has more homicides of youth under the age of 21 than any city in America. 500 kids were under the age of 21 were killed since 2008, and 80% of them were in about 20 communities in the city. So this is clearly a huge problem. The Tribune did a series a couple years ago about the dozens of Chicago public school kids who were getting killed, and I think that sort of sparked a lot of interest in this subject. So we have some distinguished panelists. I think you all have the bios on them. I'm just going to quickly introduce them and let them get started. I'm not sure where everybody's sitting, but Robin Jacob is an assistant research scientist at the University of Michigan School of Education and the Institute for School Research. She's the co-founder of the Education and Well-Being Program, and her research sort of centers on something that's really lacking in education, which is evaluating interventions and seeing how they help instruction and outcomes for kids. I know more about education than I do about criminal justice, but in education, it's littered with programs that don't work or that have never been evaluated, so she sort of focuses on that. I think everybody here probably knows Jean-Claude Brizard, or JC as everybody calls him. He had the pleasure, I guess, of being appointed CEO of Chicago Public Schools. Before that, he was superintendent of schools for Rochester. And before that, he was regional superintendent of New York City Department of Education. And I think he'd probably rightly take offense at the last comment that the schools in New York City are as bad as they were before.
Tremendous.
Yeah, because the truth is that they're actually not as bad as they were before, for lots of reasons, academic-wise, in one way. Evelyn Diaz is here. She is the recently appointed commissioner of the Chicago Department of Family and Support Services. She was appointed by Rahm Emanuel last year. And before that, she was the CEO of the Chicago Workforce Investment Council. And she also served a while ago as Deputy Chief of Staff in the Office of the Mayor. And finally, we have Susana Vasquez, who is the Executive Director of the LISC Chicago. Prior to that, she was the Director of the New Communities Program, which is a project that comprehensively redeveloped 16 Chicago neighborhoods. And I'm not going to tell you too much about what they do. I'm going to sort of work that into the Q&A after we get started. So.
It's really a pleasure to be here. It's really nice to be back in Chicago. I spent 5 years in graduate school at the University of Chicago and spent a great deal of time in the Chicago Public Schools, and so it's really a pleasure to be back here talking with all of you about this really important issue. I'm going to talk about evidence from research in terms of thinking about education strategies for reducing crime and violence, and then I'll really be interested in hearing from the esteemed panel that I'm sitting up here with about things on the ground and how what we talk about today applies there. Just really briefly, I want to set the context for this conversation. We've been talking about this a lot today, but clearly there is a clear association between educational progress and crime. We know that the homicide rate is 50% higher for high school dropouts compared to high school graduates. 68% of black male high school dropouts will spend time in prison by the time they're 35. And if you look at statistics from the Cook County Jail, many of the 18 to 20-year-old inmates are up to 7 grades behind their counterparts in terms of reading and math. And it's not just perpetrators of crime and violence, but it's also victimization as well. So whether or not you've graduated from high school or college is a huge predictor about whether you're going to be a victim of a homicide as well. So it's clear that there is a strong association between crime and education. The way I want to think about this today is to think about this not as improving education in a larger sense. We talk a lot about educational interventions that are trying to raise the bar overall. And I think what we want to think about today as we're thinking about these issues of crime are thinking about the very highest risk students in our schools. So I think we've talked about this a bunch this morning, but 6% of every birth cohort is responsible for 60 to 70% of all the violent crime. And I think what we want to do is think about educational interventions that are going to be focused really on the bottom part of the distribution and see what we can do for those students to prevent this from happening down the line. So that's what I'm going to be talking about a little bit today. There's 4 things that I would like to put on the table that I think we should consider. The first I'm only going to mention briefly because I think in general we're all on board with this, but the first is early intervention. And I think the research out there really shows that early intervention programs like preschool and Head Start programs can have really lasting impacts on life outcomes for kids. And so while the educational benefits of these early intervention programs tend to fade over time, there's a number of studies out there that show that things like arrests and crime are actually reduced and are longer lasting effects of these programs. And I bring this up for two reasons. One, because I think it highlights the fact that we can make a difference in children's lives. And second, because I think that the earlier we are able to intervene in children's lives, the better. And so as we're thinking about the K through 12 context, I want us to think about trying to catch the highest risk kids as early as possible and helping them out. The three other things that I'm going to talk about in more detail today. One is better using data to monitor and track individual students. The second are thinking about educational interventions that have a research base that shows that they really do help the lowest achieving students improve their educational outcomes. And that is two things. One is more instruction, and the second is more individualized instruction. And then finally, a topic that is near and dear to my heart because it's what I've been spending the last couple years working on, is thinking about ways to integrate building self-regulation skills in kids as part of the regular classroom environment. So thinking about data and monitoring. So we know that many precursors to later problems are evident very early on. Over 50% of diagnosed mental and behavioral problems have their first symptoms in children 10 years of age or younger. We can look at the dropout program, and I think Tim alluded to this as well. Dropout is always preceded by chronic truancy. It starts very early. Third graders who miss more than 2 weeks of school are twice as likely to drop out of school as their counterparts who miss fewer than 2 weeks of school. So that suggests that we should not be addressing the dropout problem in 9th or 10th grade when kids are getting ready to drop out, but we should be looking for the kids who we know early on are at real high risk for those problems. But I think in terms of thinking about juvenile crime and delinquency, we don't know as much as we could or should about who we should be intervening with. And especially in this time of very limited resources, we want to be able to intervene most effectively. And so I think we need to do a better job of creating predictive models that would tell us more about who are the kids that are most likely to be involved in crime and violent crime as they reach adolescence. And so while it's true that we know that 50% of diagnosed mental and behavior problems exhibit their first symptoms in children 10 years of age, it's not necessarily the case that every kid who is punching Johnny on the playground is going to end up a criminal by the time they're an adolescent. Furthermore, and it's also not the case that every kid who becomes involved in crime as an adolescent actually exhibited those behaviors early on. And so I think we need to do a better job of utilizing data to try to put together some predictive models in the way that the consortium has done in terms of school dropout to really identify who are the kids who are most at risk and how we can intervene. And so I'll just put in a plug for sharing data between the criminal justice system and education. And I know that it's a sometimes politically difficult thing to do, but I think Jens and the Crime Lab has done a good job of trying to move in that direction, and I think it's a really important thing for us to do to try to get at this problem. Other ways I think we need to do a better job of using data. So as Stephanie indicated, I spend my life evaluating educational interventions. Most educational interventions, when we evaluate them, we do so over a very short time horizon. We look at the impacts over 2 to 3, maybe 5 years. And we look at the impacts of educational interventions on academic outcomes, rightly so. But I think it's important that we start to look at broader set of outcomes as well, and to track children over a longer period of time. It would be really nice to know that by intervening with kids who are 2 or 3 years below grade level in reading, by implementing a program like Reading Recovery, which has shown to be successful, if we could also say, look, and those kids are less likely to be involved in crime, they're less likely to drop out of school. And I feel like we don't have as much data as we should to speak to those kinds of issues. And then finally, more on a micro level, I think we could do a better job of using assessments of individual students to help teachers better target their interventions with students. And I'm not talking about more standardized testing. I'm talking about short diagnostic tests that help a teacher know, you know, these are the areas that Bobby is really struggling in, and these are the places that I need to intervene. And I think a lot of successful interventions do use frequent assessments to help target interventions as appropriately as they possibly can. So In my 10 to 15 years evaluating educational interventions, what I usually find is that they don't work, and it's a very depressing existence. So in preparing for this presentation, it was actually refreshing to go back to the What Works Clearinghouse and go back through the research and look at the things that really have been shown to work. And so what emerged from my very happy investigation into successful programs were two key themes that seemed to run through most of the successful educational interventions. The first is more instructional time, and the second is more individualized instruction. So instructional time, it's a key element of a number of different successful programs. There's been a lot of publicity about the KIPP and charter schools with longer school days and longer school years. There's been a lot out there about double doses of either reading or math instruction, which have been shown to have positive impacts. And a lot of tutoring programs, the key piece of that is that it's just more time spent on reading and math. I would say also that I think especially in this time of decreased resources, that a little bit of extra time can go a long way to keeping kids engaged. I think we spend a lot of time these days having kids at their desks reading and doing math without enough time to explore other interests that they have and to get the wiggles out. So, you know, I think about my own son who is 7 years old, and with a really short school day and a really strong focus on reading and math, I mean, he's crazy at the end of the day. So our little kids need time to be able to get up and move around, and more instructional time leaves more time to focus on academic subjects, but also more time to allow students to do those other important things that help keep them engaged. I think the longer school day in CPS is gonna go a long way towards help addressing some of those issues. And then the second thing that emerged in a lot of what I was looking at was individualized instruction. I think one of the biggest challenges that teachers face in the classroom is the heterogeneity of the students that they're working with. And how do you target instruction to a really broad range of students with varying abilities? One-on-one tutoring is a great way to be able to individualize instruction and make sure that you're meeting the needs of that particular child. Reading recovery has had really great success with this approach. Tutoring can be expensive. I am encouraged. There are a number of tutoring programs that are being developed right now that are trying to utilize community volunteers with a strong training program to help provide tutoring, and I do think that's something that is worth looking into and considering a lower cost way of providing this one-on-one tutoring. Another way of individualizing instruction is ability grouping. Success for All, which also has had a lot of success in raising the achievement of the lowest performing students. They ability group for reading. They assess frequently. They regroup by ability so that teachers can really target the instruction for the level that the kids are at. And they do a lot of paired instruction so that students are helping one another, but everyone's kind of at the same level, and that really helps people to move along. At the same time, kids aren't stuck in a particular level. They get reassessed all the time and moved up if they're progressing. And then I think computer-adapted instruction, utilizing technology to be able to give kids a little bit of extra time focused on the things that they need, is another promising way to think about individualizing instruction for our students. The final thing I want to talk about is focusing on not just academic skills, but building kids' self-regulation skills. And I think about self-regulation in three broad domains: emotional regulation. So what do I do when I get angry and frustrated? How can I bring that level of frustration or anger down? And I think that it has a huge impact on the way kids are able to engage in school. If I am doing a math problem and I get so frustrated I can't see straight, I'm not going to be able to work through that and seek the help that I need. Similarly, if every time somebody bumps into me, I am so angry I want to throttle them, that's not a productive way to be engaged in school. Behavioral regulation, learning to understand that emotions and behaviors are not the same thing. So you can be really angry, and that doesn't mean that you have to go slug the kid who made you angry. And learning to understand and interpret the behaviors of others. So there's a lot of psychological research out there that shows that hostile attribution bias, which is interpreting an action, an ambiguous action on the part of another as hostile, leads to a lot of violent reactions. So Johnny spills milk on me in the lunchroom, do I assume that it was an accident, or do I assume he did it on purpose? And a lot of kids from dysregulated environments come in. Everything that they've known has told them that I should interpret that as hostile and behave accordingly. And to the extent that we can intervene and help kids understand that it may not always be hostile and that in an ambiguous situation you need to assess, I think could go a long way to reducing conflict in our schools. And then finally, issues of cognitive regulation, which I think are directly related to academic achievement. Things like attention, memory, inhibition. Can I sit in class and remember to raise my hand when I'm really excited, or do I just blurt out the answer? Can I focus on my schoolwork and tune out all the other stuff that's going on outside? These things have been associated with both behavioral and academic outcomes, in particular school engagement, and I think it's worth really thinking about ways that we can weave them into the academic curriculum. And I say weave them into the academic curriculum because I know that there's not a lot of time. I'm currently working with colleagues to develop an intervention of this sort, and what we hear every time we go into the school is, yeah, this is great, yeah, this is what our kids need, don't have the time to do it. But I do think that there are ways that it can be infused as part of the regular academic curriculum and doesn't really require that we take a lot of time out of reading or math to do it. So setting up classroom structures and routines and mediators to help students do things like pay attention, manage their emotions, follow directions, I think there is promise in that. There's a number of good examples out there. There's the Head Start Ready program, which infused within the Head Start program a self-regulation program. It has shown very promising results with increased achievement, academic engagement, and particularly fewer aggressive behaviors. One of my colleagues has developed a program called the 4 R's, which it's a literacy curriculum. So it is a literacy curriculum, but what they talk about as part of that literacy curriculum are these emotional and behavioral regulation issues. They've also found positive results in terms of both self-reported and teacher-reported aggressive behavior in early elementary school. And then I'm working on a program called Secure, which also tries to infuse self-regulation skills within in the regular academic day. So things for us to think about. I think it's very easy for those highest risk children that we've been talking about today to slip through the cracks in our system, and I think it is the case that there are some policies that help most students that may hurt some of the highest risk students, for example, more credits required to graduate. So we really need to think about ways to identify those kids early on and get them the help they need. More data, better and more individualized instruction, and expanding our focus beyond just academic skills in our schools. Thanks.
Okay, well, thank you. Excuse me. Thank you. That was really interesting. I want to sort of... two things that you said or sort of themes that I want to pick up on are sort of the fact that we don't know which interventions work, and the ones that we do know that work, we either don't expand them or there's political fights about whether or not they work. And also this idea of focusing on the, I don't want to say bottom, but for lack of a better word, sort of the kids that are causing the most trouble. I think that's both controversial and sort of difficult to address. So sort of the theme of this, if we can maybe talk about those two things. And JC, I'm wondering if you can, if I got this right, Robin, you, the things that you listed were early intervention, data and monitoring, and individualized instruction. Those are sort of the things. And those are all things that Chicago has addressed over time. I'm wondering if you can maybe take them one by one where we are. But before you do that, I'm wondering if you could talk a bit about when Huberman was CEO, he launched a program, I don't remember what it was called, it was about $30 million, and it sort of did exactly this. He had this sort of metric where he picked the 200 kids that were most at risk, and he spent tons of money on these kids, giving them mentors, helping them find jobs. And I'm curious, did it work? Did anybody ever measure it? What happened to it?
You know, it's a great question. The program had Culture of Calm, Safe Haven, mentoring programs, peace circles. In some schools, it has been tremendously beneficial. If you look at what the Finger is doing, it's been really amazing. I think you went to, was it Marshall?
Marshall,
we met. Really beneficial in terms of watching the school actually come down. No one's done a study to see actually how it's working. From our vantage point, we've seen some great things in some schools, But we also are seeing mixed results in other kinds of programs across some of those interventions. What we've not seen is the perhaps a requisite scale up of that model. So you have a number of schools who have received tremendous amounts of money for that kind of intervention, much of the money coming from school improvement grants and came from ERA funds. And as those dollars go away, the difficulties in keeping that kind of program. I think the trick is to make sure it becomes embedded in the culture of a school and perhaps not require additional or outside funding to actually sustain the program. But again, in some schools, it has been really, really good and it's really calmed down the environment quite well. But we've not seen the scale up and we worry about the funding and ways of sustaining that. And we have other things we're working on to address some of those issues. But currently, one of our worries is that it's going to end and not continue. So if I may go to the presentation, early intervention, individualized instruction was the third one. You
want data and monitoring.
Oh, data. So absolutely on target. So we know that what happens in pre-K, kindergarten, first and second grade, and even maybe all the way to the age of eight, has tremendous potential in terms of improving students' lives or put them on a trajectory for failure. And I'm going to argue that beyond the early grades, beyond early childhood, that the middle school intervention, I think, is also critical. There was a work done by Bob Balfons at the Johns Hopkins in Baltimore City. I forgot the exact number. But I think he was able to show the connection between attendance and dropout. I think that was mentioned in the press presentation. I think what he showed was that the average dropout missed about 200 years of school between sixth and eighth grade. So if you can begin to watch that, you can begin to see where kids are actually going. So the issues around early childhood is one that we all know has to be done, that we have to find quality programs for kids and make sure that they are attending. That's something that we have been working on as a district. You saw the mayor announce recently with also with prevention and others, ways of beginning to measure the quality of these programs, not just number of seats, but how good they are across the city. So that work is clearly underway. I'm going to leave the, I'm going to combine the individualizing data because I think they are connected. One thing we have a lot of in education, and the expression we often use is drip, data rich, information poor. Teachers and principals are inundated with a lot of information, both qualitative and quantitative. What we often are missing is the good analytics, the analysis to actually respond to the questions that we need to ask about what is or what is not happening in classrooms across the district. We have not invested well in good data systems. We don't have processes in place at the central office level or at the school level to inform the work of principals and teachers. We're getting better at it, but we're not there yet. So if you take literacy as a very specific example, you've got a lot of schools focusing on things like DIBLs or other kinds of assessment tools. Each one will give you an answer to a slice of the problem, but we don't have a comprehensive way of looking at the totality of the issue of why a child is not reading to learn or learning how to read. So combining these assessments and finding the best ways to inform the work of principals and teachers in a formative sense is one that we are working on, not just at the school level, but the classroom level, at the student level. The second challenge that we have as school systems is that we were never designed to address individual students' needs. If you think back to when you were a student in school, teachers taught, some got it, some didn't, and we moved on. I think Michael Barber from Britain was here 2 days ago, or was it yesterday, I forgot which day, actually talking about this very specifically. But now we have a challenge of educating every single student. We can't just leave some behind anymore because there's no industry to support them when they begin to drop out of school. And our master schedules don't allow, especially at the high school level, doesn't allow for individualization. So think back to high school. If you have a 10th grader not getting social studies, what happens, right? Nothing. And the next year, they take the same class again. We do repetition in high school, not remediation, right? You take it over and over as if something magical is going to happen the second or third time around. So the master schedule does not allow for that kind of intervention. If you saw our push around the full school day or the longer school day, we got some private funding to get some high schools, about $100,000 a piece, to get some outside consultants and help to blow up the master schedule, to look for ways of really creating that kinds of individualized attention. The one great nugget, the one great hope in all of this is the technology. We're seeing newer and better technologies, adaptive kinds of assessments that really are giving us the kinds of analysis we need to tell exactly what skills and where kids are falling behind. We're seeing classroom data sets giving us the red, green, yellow, which specific skills is missing to group and regroup kids accordingly to allow for that kind of intervention to actually take place. Dreambox is one of the biggest tools used by the rocket ship charter schools in California with tremendous results in mathematics. And the Classroom of One, now being called New Classrooms, is coming to Chicago next fall, thanks to our to local funders here, is a program that looks at individual remediation and intervention daily. So imagine right now we have these assessments that are quarterly or three or four times a year that gives us information back for us to actually address. New Classrooms has an algorithm that measures what you have and have not learned every single day, and by 4 p.m. changes the teacher's schedule for the next day, changes the student's schedule for the next day. That is coming to us from three schools here in the fall. So we're using beginning to use technology to get to that kind of information, but ultimately it's going to need to actually change the master schedule to allow for teachers and principals with more time to do what has to be done. So we know what needs to be done. The big question, the big challenge is to scale up the work that we have to do.
Before I let you off the hook, I'm just curious on the culture of, what is the culture?
It's culture of calm.
Culture of calm. Is it done? Is it over with?
No, it's still, everything is still in place. And we actually made an investment, although ERA funds went away, to keep the program for this year. But as our fiscal conditions get worse and worse every single year, we'll have to find new ways to make sure that kind of programming or that kind of is integrated within the fabric of a school. So the challenge for us is to sustain it. SIG is around for a little bit longer, but ERA has actually gone away.
We could spend a whole conference talking about the challenges of funding, right?
Yes.
So Commissioner Diaz, maybe you could explain a little bit about what your organization does, what your agency does, and then talk about how you intersect with sort of this idea of keeping kids in school, off the streets, and away from crime.
Great. Sure, thank you. So quickly, the department actually, Department of Family and Support Services in the city actually is responsible for all the human services delivered in the city, from early childhood, workforce development, domestic violence, homelessness, general human services, youth services, and senior services. So that's kind of the scope of the department, which is huge. But on youth services in particular, I was encouraged really in my first few weeks in the job to take a very close look at how we're doing youth services. And since then, I've really dived in and have discovered a few things. So let me give you kind of an overview of what we do with youth services. We are responsible for providing funding for after-school, out-of-school programs for young people. We do that with 260 unique delegate agencies across the city and serve about a little over 20,000 kids per year. We have, over the years, I discovered, took an approach to how we think about youth services, that we needed to cover as many kids as possible, that we needed to provide as many out-of-school time opportunities as possible, because the thinking was giving expanded learning opportunities to as many kids as possible is going to help school outcomes, youth development, that it's just generally a good thing. When I looked at how do we know that these 260 organizations that we work with are doing a good job, what do they see as their goal? What is our goal in funding these programs? What I learned was that there is really no strong mandate that our department has made to the 260 agencies about what it is that we are all collectively up to. The goal isn't always clear, and it is not at all measured. So what we know is that we've taken our tens of millions of dollars in resources. We've done a fantastic job of spreading them all across the city. The result is that each organization gets a very small grant, on average about $35,000, which I would argue is insufficient for them to serve a good number of kids with a high quality program. They would probably say the same. And they see their job as providing after school opportunities for kids, keeping them entertained, keeping them moving in the case of recreational programs, keeping them, in the case of some of our academic programs, helping them with homework, right? So it's all, from a social service perspective, good services. However, no one, I found, could tell me that collectively those programs were helping to address the three biggest crises facing young people in the city today: high dropout rates, high unemployment, and high violence, high crime. And so it seemed to me that as the city's kind of largest funder of after-school or out-of-school time programs, at the very least we could say the purpose of our programs needs to be that we are trying to address one of those three problems, and we're gonna measure to see whether we're having an impact, right? So so I don't know if that kind of gives an overview about where we're starting, right, with the department, is just recognizing that we don't have a lot of good data. We don't know which programs work. There hasn't been a lot of good direction setting, mandates about what we're working on. And the way we've set up the system, we reach a lot of kids in a lot of different neighborhoods, but it's not at all strategic. And I would argue that we need to get much more efficient about how we distribute those resources.
So I'm curious if you've announced this to the folks that you're funding, and what was their reaction to, you might not be getting money if you can't prove you're effective. Mm-hmm.
So this is the big problem, right, that I see, is that it's really easy to say we need to be more strategic, we need to get more targeted, maybe we don't need to be providing services in one community. How about we combine services and serve three communities through one or two organizations? That makes sense to us. It is a much harder proposition to the communities themselves, who've had the benefit of these services provided to their community members, right? And so the biggest challenge ahead, and one that I think is worth taking, is that we have to start moving toward a greater funding efficiency. So saying, $35,000 a year isn't enough money for any single organization to provide high quality services and do all of the kind of tracking and measurement we're going to start requiring. So maybe we need to start consolidating, funding fewer agencies with bigger grants, asking them for more. And I don't think you can just do that in one day. I think it is something that you have to do kind of slowly over time. The other big challenge, though, is that is exactly what Dr. Jacob said, which is we don't know enough about what works. So we can say we want to fund more programs that have a high impact on school engagement. We want to fund more programs that reduce crime. But unfortunately, there's not a whole lot of information, good data that tells us exactly what are those program models, right? Which is why I was, I think the Crime Lab's study, their BAM study, is so exciting, because for the first time, a lot of funders in this room, myself included, were really excited that there was some rigorous evaluation on a program model that had a demonstrated impact on violence reduction. That's the kind of thing we all want to fund. The next big question is, are there other models? How replicable is the BAM model? How do we scale that up without, decreasing the quality of the program, right? Because the instructors, the very trained instructors in the Becoming a Man mentoring program are very highly trained. It's a very specific model, so you can't just quickly replicate it. So I think it's hard to imagine making a big shift quickly without having really good data on what works and how we can address the issue that you would be taking away services in certain communities. I think it is, as you said earlier, politically very challenging.
Right. And we'll, JC will have to do that, right? Susana, maybe you can talk a little bit about LISC, and then tell us sort of, from your vantage point, what do you think are the most effective programs that you've seen to sort of keep kids on track in school? I mean, I want to talk about truancy in a minute, but sort of keep them on track in school and away from violence, from what you're seeing.
Sure. Again, and thank you for the opportunity to be part of this panel. LISC, Local Initiative Support Corporation, we're not a social service agency. We're an intermediary working on behalf of neighborhoods. So we organize financial resources and invest technical assistance to help build neighborhood capacity. And this is a very intriguing question, and certainly one that we're in the middle of understanding as well. I think a couple of points in terms of what we've seen as effective and some of the contradictions or challenges or cautions about what we're talking about here, which is this notion of evidence-based approaches, researching the approaches versus funding the approaches, taking the one model that may have had the benefit of being studied, therefore it is seen as evidence-based, versus the other really good model developed by a neighborhood that hasn't had the benefit of being researched and therefore it is not deemed yet evidence-based. From my perspective, in terms of what works in a neighborhood, is first making sure that neighborhood works. One of the challenges of scaling up programs, I think, is that you need to understand the local context. I think Zimmering even raised this. There's this the tension between the structural and the situational, the variable and the fixed. And Derek mentioned this last night. When we study programs to see what works, we're not always getting down to the nitty-gritty about which drivers were the most effective. Is it the charismatic leader of Jeffrey Canada versus the millions of dollars that are funding it versus this very comprehensive cradle parenting skills model that's the most effective? So I think first what works is understanding the neighborhood, understanding that if you just drop in a program that was developed outside from another set of players, that local neighborhood might just reject it because they don't have the ownership of it. That once that model, even if it is evidence-based, gets stopped funding and is removed from that neighborhood, you've not built any local capacity to ongoingly do that. And there's a tension because, and Matt Stagner's here, so you know we're in this. LISC has been fortunate to work with funders and actually move forward on some models. We're in a program funded by Atlantic Philanthropies called Elevate, which is in five CPS schools, middle schools, integrating health centers, academic enrichment, after-school programs, and social supports. And we have the evidence, attendance is up, disciplinary issues are down, on-track performance, and yet the funder is moving away from funding this. So there is still a tension that when you start having the evidence, it doesn't mean that the funding is going to stick with it. The last couple points I would raise is we do have, I'll give one example. You're asking for something that we do think that has worked. One of the programs that has started up in the comprehensive work we've done in neighborhoods, it started in Pilsen and we've scaled it up to 12 neighborhoods, so this question of how you scale things up. Is called B-Ball on the Block, a seemingly very innocent basketball program that has activated contested space in neighborhoods, taking blocks that are usually gang hangouts and every Friday night turning them into basketball tournaments for kids, has activated informal social controls. You are reclaiming the space and having parents there, having cops there in a positive sense. And for $50,000 over the summer, engaging 12 neighborhoods and youth for about 8 weeks. And because we've been pushed by MacArthur and others to start looking at, well, what is the data and what is the impact of your work? And because the city of Chicago has now a data portal, which if you spend enough hours, you can get the crime data, We had one of our journalists sort of do an analysis in East Garfield Park of a block. Breakthrough Urban Ministries runs the BBAL program in East Garfield Park. And on the block where this program was going on, compared to a block where we had invested in sort of cleaning up a plaza, but there was no activated space going on, the crime had dropped 50% over the summer compared to that comparison block. Okay, now we've known, because of the qualitative information that our locals will tell us, this is working, this is reducing crime. But then when we backed into to see, well, what does the data tell us, it sort of reinforced it. However, it hasn't been studied by you all yet. We'd welcome it. That sort of my pushback or nudge is I think neighborhoods want to be supportive of being part of evidence-based work and making an impact. They want it more than anything. However, we have to be cautious about the two things. One, everything hasn't been studied yet, but that doesn't mean it's not working. And two, and it was great that Superintendent McCarthy said this, we still have to innovate. And innovation by its nature is not evidence-based. And so there has to be a way where we carve out that space to build local capacity, which means you just can't drop in the tested program, still allow for innovation because everything constantly changes, and figure out how we're going to solve for this tension between providing the services for youth, in this example, and testing to see if the service we're providing is having an impact.
I'm going to think while I talk here, which could be really dangerous, so just sort of bear with me here. I'm curious about sort of this idea of first do no harm. I mean, I want to go back to the longer school day idea. You mentioned that there are things that can be bad for kids, like extra credits. That could, you know, maybe force kids to drop out. I'm sort of curious, this is in the news a lot, the longer school day. And then tying it back to what Susana just said about what is it that we know about Harlem Children's Zone? Is it that it's a great program, or is it that it has Jeffrey Canada with a lot of big backers? And I think I'd ask the same thing about KIPP. Yes, they have a longer school day, and yes, they do really well, but is it because they have a longer school day? I mean, I would probably argue no, it's not because they have a longer school day. So I'm sort of curious for all of you to address this issue of, okay, we lengthen the school day. Is there any concern that the kids that are already on the edge might drop out or become more chronically truant? And have we, for JC, I guess, have we thought about that? What do you do about that? I mean, Robin, if you could talk a bit about your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right. So I'll say first that I do think that there is a lot of evidence that more time on academic skills is good for students' achievement. That's not the only outcome that we actually care about, and a longer school day doesn't mean that that time is getting used well. And so I think you're right. I think we don't know the details about whether the KIPP success is being driven specifically by the extended school day and the additional time. But I do think we do know that more time on academic subjects helps kids improve. But I think the bigger issue is that more time has to be used well. And I think using it well means both focusing on the improving the skills that kids are lacking, and also using that time to help keep kids engaged. And that's part of what I said. I think a longer school day that is just filled with, you know, 3 hours of reading and 3 hours of math is not gonna get us where we wanna go. I think it has to be a comprehensive look at how do we use that time most effectively in ways that are gonna both improve academics and keep kids engaged in school and give them access to a lot of different things. I'd be interested.
JC, I'm just curious if you thought about that.
So I completely agree, and I will argue that KIPP's success nationally is partly based on the extra time that they give kids for success. But it's not just the time, it's what happens within that time. It's what happens around teacher development, leadership development. So it's not a one-dimensional strategy, it's gotta have all of the above. If you take a look at our guidance to principals, it includes the time on task. It includes a lot of time for intervention, one-on-one or small group intervention, allows for recess, which disappeared from our district. So it allows for enrichment, allows for a comprehensive push around redefining the school day. But again, it's not just that. It's about looking at the quality of the adults in our buildings as well. So to focus on one thing and say this is going to be a panacea, a magic bullet, I think is foolhardy. It really is a tool that we need to use to begin to address a lot of other things to actually make the system actually successful. Jeffrey Callett tells a story about pushing his folks to work on Saturdays and Sundays for kids who needed the extra work. He got pushed back his first year. And he told them that if we fail, I'll fire myself, but I'll be the last one to go. And the following year, when the scores weren't great, everyone volunteered to work Saturdays and Sundays.
Does anybody else want to? I think I have to open up for questions in just a minute here. I want to talk a little bit about truancy, because we know that that's sort of one of the main markers of what kids are going to drop out and more inclined to be involved in violence. As JC mentioned, I spent a year at Marshall High School last year, and the amount of effort that they put into getting kids to school. I mean, when the beginning of the year, I think the attendance rate was about 48%. So on any day, half the kids weren't there. By the end of the school year, it was up to maybe 75, somewhere around in there. But the Herculean efforts, I mean, we went out with what I would call truancy officers. They had a much fancier name. I don't know what they called them, intervention specialists or something. And we were literally chasing kids through laundromats and in their houses and dragging them back. And we saw, and I wish, the superintendent's not here, but I would like to ask him what is their role in sort of this truancy problem. But it was very costly, and I'm not sure completely effective, because we would drag them into school and they would sit there sort of angry and not wanting to be there. So I'm wondering if you can, anybody here can sort of talk about the truancy problem and how do you address that? What do we know that works to get these kids back in? And once they're there, I think that's, once they're back in school, what do you do for them?
So I'll start. I think it was Tim Knowles who talked about the ninth grade data point. I'll argue that it's actually seventh or eighth grade. If you take a look at what we did in New York City, and I'll argue the system got much better in New York City, looking at eighth grade cut scores in math and literacy, we were able to draw a perfect line between eighth grade literacy scores and high school dropout or graduation 4 years. So high school principals know who's coming, very often don't prepare for those kids who are coming in. In our city, at any given time, I've got about 60,000 kids who are out in the streets, dropped out, chronically truant, or long-term absent, and the interventions have been really inadequate. So we have a problem of pipeline, meaning kids leaving our system, and a secondary problem of re-engaging them back into schools. When you take a look at a dropout rate, which is about 40-somewhat percentage points in the city, it's astronomical. I've got schools right now I want to reconstitute who have dropout rates of 60%, yet you're getting pushback from the community about closing or redoing those particular schools. But the 60,000 kids, so we go back to practice and policy. We have a system in our district where you have to drop out first before you can access the alternative high school system, which is completely crazy. And at the same time, we have about 5,500 seats. And my understanding is about 25,000 kids are actually looking to access that system, with 60,000 walking in the street. So we have a capacity issue. We have an issue of a pipeline. And to fix it, we talk about two things: preventive or prevention. How do you create the academic programs that supports looking at ninth grade on track, looking at eighth grade scores, looking at attendance from elementary to secondary to prevent kids from dropping out, creating the kinds of support systems they need, whether it be social, emotional, or academic. And by the way, I will argue that when I looked with our work in New York City high schools, we found that close to 10% of the dropouts walked into high school reading at 12th grade level. So it's not just an academic issue. So people say that kids are falling behind and drop out. Often it's a boredom issues, all the kinds of life issues that we also have to address. So the second slice of the work is what we're calling recuperative. I didn't coin the words. It's one we've done in different cities across the country. Is how do we re-engage dropouts back into a program? Putting them back, or taking them from the laundromats and putting them back in the same environment that produced them from walking out in the first place, is not going to be what's going to create success. So what do we change within the school structure or outside the school structure to allow these kids to get a credential within a year or two? And there are models around the country we can actually leverage. And quickly, we actually just re-engaged the Carnegie Corporation, Michelle Cahill. I work with in New York, who's now back at Carnegie, and she's an expert in this work around the country, to help us think through how we're going to solve this 60,000 student who are walking our streets and the pipeline of kids who are leaving our high schools every single day problem.
Just so you know, they weren't like at the laundromat doing laundry. They're doing something else. And it involves sitting on the machines. Commissioner Diaz, I wonder if you can respond at all to that. I mean, sort of, is there anything your agency can do with this truancy problem?
So this is a, so short, you know, I said earlier that shortly after I started getting some pressure to focus on our youth services and what is it that you do and how is it that you'll be supporting the Chicago Police Department? How will you be supporting the Chicago Public Schools? So I sat down with JC, I sat down with the superintendent, and it's very clear that they need social services, our social services, to be aligned with their goals and some of the issues that they're seeing, truancy, other kids who clearly need some help at home, so not just student interventions, but entire family interventions. What I said was that we're really not set up to do it that way. Right, we're really not set up to send trained caseworkers, therapists, to go do family interventions on a case-by-case basis with the schools. We don't have that capacity now. And as I was explaining earlier, what we do with our tens of millions of dollars is give it to community agencies, 260 of them, to provide after-school programs. So if we were to decide, and this is somewhere I think we need to be going as a city. If we were to decide that it is my department's responsibility for our youth services to support the Chicago Public School goals and to support the Chicago Police Department's goals, we would have to either call back all the money and say we're no longer going to do after school or focus on after school programs, but rather focus on enriching, figuring out how to integrate, say, the kind of enrichment programs that happen after school into the longer school day. Figure out how to mobilize resources for helping out with the truancy question. Or if we don't call back all the money, simply say, you know, effective on this certain day, now all of our grants are going to be about supporting schools, supporting the police department. And I think what, you know, what I said earlier about the political difficulty of that is really that what you're saying to someone, everybody here, not everybody, but I'd bet that a good number of people here can remember a time that they participated in a program over the summer or during the school year that had a huge impact on their lives. And it could be a day camp or a summer program. It could be anything like that. And imagine if somebody said to you that because resources are tight, we're going to pull all that money. It's no longer available to you. We're going to just focus it on this certain group of kids, either in CPS or those kids that are being arrested, right? People would have a very difficult time with that, right? I think it is a very difficult place for government to be, to say that we're going to take away these resources here to put them in this other place. Even if we have all of the theory and the statistics that say that that's actually a better use of the money. And so that's where I think we need to be going, what it would take is would be a massive shift in policy, a massive kind of a lift in terms of getting all of our elected officials on board with that change, our communities on board with that change. So let me leave it at that. I think that's what we need to be doing, but I think it's going to be a really hard thing to pull off.
Cool. I'll open up to questions, but it's under pressure. One second. Are you willing to do that?
I'm willing to talk about it like this, right?
Just you and me?
Because at the end of the day, it starts with a conversation, and it's an echo chamber. And the more people start to believe that that is where we need to be going, the easier case I'll have in making these changes. And we are starting to make some incremental changes, right? This year, even, we're starting to say we're going to start requiring people to demonstrate to us, show us how you're impacting one of the three biggest crises in the city, right? We're starting to move in that direction, but I think it's going to be, it won't be quick unless there's some massive pressure to change how we do it. And I think that that we have to start talking about it and getting people on board first.
So what you're saying is we're going to see your name in the paper a lot surrounded with swear words soon. I'm going to open it up for questions. Do we need a microphone, or I don't know if we need it. But.
Is it okay if I start?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so my name is Alexander Gale, Sherman Civic Consulting Alliance. This is a great panel, and I really appreciate it. I want to ask you the opposite of the question I asked the first panel. So I asked them how the judicial, the prosecutorial, and the police functions could work together more effectively as a system. And the response I got was they're working fine. What they need is to integrate better with the social service side, with the education, the community-based organizations, and the support services. So I'd love to hear from you if you have ideas from the judicial, prosecutorial, or police side how they could better support your missions. What would you like to see in future in Chicago, how those that system could support your work better?
You want to start? So I'll talk about my experience actually working. And many of you know, my first teaching experience was at Rikers Island in Queens, New York, working with inmates, teen inmates. What I found was that there was absolutely no connection, even though we were a part of the school system, and we were living inside of a jail, basically. No connection between what the warden was doing, the COs were doing, and what the teachers were doing. Absolutely no connection. In fact, it's why I left, because it was depressing. I would come back from lunch, and the kid I was working with for 6 months disappeared. No one talked to me about him leaving, going to a different part of the institution. We have an issue of kids who are going in and coming out of these prisons with no transition plans whatsoever. We have no idea what they learn in jail very often, and how that translates back into their high school experience. They were behind in the first place, which is why they were on the streets, which is why they ended up in jail, and they come back even more angry than they were before. Teachers and principals have no idea who these children are, and have no idea what the history is, and now have to figure out how to educate them. So better information exchanges, I think, will be tremendous. Ways of us planning together when a child's about to exit an institution, for the school, where they're going to go, to sit and plan with the, would be wonderful. It doesn't happen, and I would love to, and I reached out to Tony Preckwinkle about doing this kind of work with the county. How do we make this happen? I'm not sure if there are laws in the way, but laws can be changed, policies can be changed, but the current practice is such that we don't talk to each other very often, and schools very often are frustrated when they're finding out this person's been out. And in New York, we developed a system of trying to figure out what school, if it was jail or not, because they come back with these special names, like Johnny was at, I don't know, Brizard Academy for the gifted or something like that, right? And after a while, you begin to understand that meant this kid was in jail. No one told us anything. And very often, we have no idea why they were incarcerated and how we're going to be able to tailor an instructional program or for that matter, a guidance program or a program to support them. So better communications, better planning, it can be done. I think if all the forces are willing to actually work with each other.
No, the only thing I would add is I actually think, I think Mr. Grady recognized it from the first panel. I think we're actually at a unique time, and particularly under Superintendent McCarthy's leadership, that there is amazing promise in terms of how I think neighborhoods can work under Superintendent McCarthy's leadership and the vision that he's laid forward and the honesty that he's bringing. I do think it requires some changing in policy and, again, some probably realignment of resources to bridge the gap between, as we were talking last night, he wants to clear, but he's expecting sort of the social service or nonprofit side to hold. And if you're gonna hold a neighborhood that the police have spent all their energies on clearing and securing, that takes resource. And so, but I think that there is a good opportunity for that to happen.
Do you, I'm just curious, do you guys all meet with him, and what sort of your connection with him? Is he part of, you meet with him constantly and you guys work together, or what's your relationship with him?
One of my staff, Carrie Blackwell, is more active in terms of being part of, sort of being participating in some of the VRS and other conversations, but and I'm on the UFC Crime Lab Advisory Committee, so those relationships are just beginning to form and figure out what the next steps would be.
Hi, my name is Andrew Schmitz. I was a teacher on the south side of Chicago, and I currently work as an assistant principal at Kipasen. I currently work as an assistant principal at Kipasen Charter School, and so I would say I totally agree with the panelists that the extended school day is just one part of what our kids really need to obtain high levels of achievement. My question is,
At times it feels like social services and social emotional learning in schools is pretty haphazard. And so I'm just wondering what can be done to make it more strategic and make it more centralized so that it is really targeting the kids and the families who need it the most and isn't just something that we do as a second tier priority, but it's really something that comes out at the top.
So I'll start on this one. I completely agree. And very often, when the dollar pressure is the first thing to disappear, are those kinds of programs. There are ways, I think, of not just at the central level, but at the school level, systemizing the work and really embedding it in the culture of a school. I'll give you a couple of examples. One is a program called The Leader in Me, which is the Carvey Institute. And my daughter, my now 10-year-old, has been part of it for a long time in her public school. And I'll tell you, she's basically embraced the seven habits of happy kids. She doesn't know what they are, but she knows how they operationalize in her life. When I ask about them, she says, "What are you talking about?" And we're stuck in a snowstorm about a year and a half ago in New York. And she went on to explain all of them without naming each one of them. That is someone who gets it, because a teacher's, a principal is in every part of the building in everything she does. The other one is one that's actually famous in Illinois called PBIS, or PBS, Positive Behavior Systems, where it becomes ingrained. Again, initially it requires some cost to get started, but once you get going, the cost of sustaining is minimal, but it becomes part of the culture of a school. But every adult has to participate in how it actually happens in the school. It's how you drink water, water fountain, how you walk in the cafeteria, how do you get your food. If someone tosses milk at you, the assumption first is not to think they're doing it on purpose, but by accident. So it's a cultural shift. It takes time to happen. It takes an entire adult staff to believe in it and make sure it's ingrained in the work that's happening in school. So all of that can be done really at minimal cost, a startup cost. When I was in Rochester, we were pushing it. We push an in-school suspension program, but we layered it with positive behaviors, and the University of Rochester was the one actually helping us implement this systematically across the schools, starting with willing principals and teachers and then pushing it out to more schools. But in those communities, it changed the discipline. The suspensions drop to near zero, but it works if it's done, if it's ingrained in the culture of a school.
And let me just add that you asked about in-school, but I think whatever strategies are implemented at CPS, we want to be using those same strategies in our out-of-school time programs. We want every instructor to having the same attitude, to incorporating the same kinds of values, principles, so that when kids leave, it isn't haphazard. It doesn't end there. When they go into their after-school program, they're getting the same kinds of reinforcements. They're getting all of that same stuff carries over. And so that hasn't happened in the past, where we've aligned what we're doing after school with some of the things that are happening in school, and that is going to change.
Yeah. So it's not the job of the social worker or the guidance counselor, it's the job of everybody in that building.
Right. Hi, Mark Myron. I'm curious, when you talk about these cultural changes to affect positive behavioral change, what are some of the successful strategies for engaging the families? It seems to me that you're going to have a great deal more success in systemizing these behaviors if you're able to engage the family. And I have heard from some of my peers who are educators that is sometimes the biggest challenge. Are there some effective strategies for doing that?
So I'll complain and I'll look for the researchers to give us the strategies. of the three levers we have to pull to fix the system, I think that is the most difficult one. Empowering and creating demand, parents would call it, at CPS. It's probably a very difficult proposition. I've seen one good example in Miami-Dade. But I went away with the last superintendent in Miami around parent engagement, parent support, and parent empowerment. But the one thing I will argue, though, is I don't know if that's always the most successful process. I believe in resiliency building, right? So I may have a parent who may never get it because he or she was 16 when she had four kids and may not know the value of this kind of work. But if you focus on the child at times and build that resiliency, you create a much better parent who may understand it down the road. So at times, it's both. It's not just focusing on families, but focusing on building the resiliency of the young people we have the locus of control around. I can't control what a mom or dad will do, but I have a lot of effect on a young person between the hours of 8 and whatever time we actually end in September.